Amazes me, I'm yours. Good morning. Good morning. A very warm welcome to St. Andrew's. Let's begin with our greeting. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. A very special welcome to those who are visiting us today, including family of David and Muriel. So it's great to have you all with us. And others who are visiting or here for the first time, so glad that you could join us this morning. And for those who are here every week, I'm delighted you could join us too. It's great to meet together. I'm David, I'm the rector here. I'm going to be leading us through our service this morning. And David Jack, one of our readers, is going to be speaking later on, and you'll hear more about that a bit later. So let's begin by praising God in song straight away. A song of praise to the Lord who gave himself for us. I cast my mind to Calvary. Oh, praise the name. Please stand to sing.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah's ill and all
we'll sing your praise.
On the third. Then on the third, at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trample death, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ.
Well, as many of you will know, 62 years ago, David was licensed as a reader and has chosen this point as time to stand down from that ministry. So David's going to be preaching to us later, and then later on in the service I'm going to be talking a little bit with him. But that means that I thought it was right to give David the choice of a passage for this morning, something that was on his heart that was kind of significant for his ministry and for us. So we're pausing our series on the character of God in favour of a wonderful and important passage from Colossians, which will be read to us a little later. But here's an opening verse from Hebrews, which ties closely into the passage that David will be speaking on later. Therefore, holy brothers and sisters who share in, fix your thoughts on Jesus, whom we acknowledge as our apostle and high priest. So let us join together in prayer. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful people and kindle in us the fire of your love through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now I'm going to invite Catherine Jones to come forward for a minute or two, just to share with us a little bit about Super Creche, about the youngest of our children's groups that meets over in the church hall. So, Catherine.
Good morning, everyone. So, really exciting numbers at the moment. We have the highest number of children in Super Creche in over 10 years. About 9 young people are coming each week to play with us during the service. But we're also at a point where we've had a number of volunteers that have been doing work with Super Creche for 9, 10, 15 years. And they've chosen, a bit like David, that it's a time for their kind of next chapter and choosing to retire with from their work with Super Creche. Which means I've got a bit of a big plea. Can anyone come and help us with the Super Creche Rota? So you don't have to be qualified with working with children. If you have ever been a parent or a grandparent or an auntie or an uncle and have just enjoyed playing with children for no more than about 45 minutes, you're absolutely made for this job. What do each week? Well, we set up the toys and then we have a little play with our Mr. Potato Heads. We have a little play with our trucks. We drive them around the carpet. And then we'll just chat with the children. We'll find out about what they're up to. And then we sit down, we have a drink and a biscuit, and we read from our big Bible story. So it's lots of fun. And actually, as a helper, you get more back. These children are just such a blessing. They've got such joy and fun each week. And it's just a really great opportunity to spend time with them. But actually what you're also doing is you're giving a massive blessing to the parents who get to come back and join you all in the congregation and just have 45 minutes where they can enjoy the worship, they can focus on God and listen to him, knowing that their children are safe and being looked after. So lots to get out of helping. I'm looking for maybe 4 or 5 people that could help. And what that would mean, you'd go on a rota, and maybe just it would be once every month, once every 6 weeks that we would ask you just to come and join us in the super creche. Take safeguarding really important here at St. Andrew's. So there will be a safeguarding check we'll just do, a DBS, but it's really straightforward. So if you're interested, please come and talk to me. I'm going over to help with super creche now, and then I'll come back at the end of the service. So anyone would like to talk to me about it, I would just love to explain more about Super Creche and see if you'd like to be involved. Thank you.
Lovely. Thanks very much indeed, Catherine. So, and thank you to all those who do work with our children and young people on a regular basis. It's hugely valuable, really appreciated. And if you want to find out more about that, then do have a chat with Catherine after the service. Or if you can't stay, then speak to me or contact the office and we'll arrange to talk to you more about the details of it. So it's time for Sunday Club, Super Creche and Amplify groups to head off now. So if you'd like to make your way to the back and over, then we'll pray for you as you go. Heavenly Father, we thank you for our children and young people. We ask for your blessing on them this morning. We pray that as they gather together, they would have fun together, that they would grow in friendship with one another, that they would grow closer to you, that they would grow to know you for themselves. And we pray that you would bless their leaders this morning and guide them in all that they're doing, and that they would know you present with them in their time together. In Jesus' name. Amen. There is also a creche available upstairs for children under 3 at any point during the service. You're welcome to just take them there at any point. So we're going to stand to sing again. If you're new here or visiting us, by the way, and you don't know some of the songs or any of the songs, don't be at all embarrassed about that. That's absolutely fine. Just enjoy it and join in when you're ready, when you get to know them. But we're going to stand to sing now about a song which is a call to have Jesus at the centre of our lives. Jesus be the centre. Cheers. Please be seated. So, one or two announcements to share with you. First one, very sadly, some of you will have met, maybe got to know a little bit, Leonard, who came to us a few months ago as a refugee from Ukraine. Leonard died earlier this week, quite suddenly and unexpectedly. So I'm sure our prayers will be with his family. I'll let you know funeral arrangements when we know, and any of you who would like to go would be very welcome. And I'll pray for the family in just a moment. On a happier note, I published The Bands of Marriage between Christopher Harold Dobson and Beverly Jane Goodall, both at the parish of Christ Church, Barmston. This is for the second time of asking. If any of you know any reason in law why they may not marry each other, you're to declare it. I'd like to just lead us in a prayer with both these things in mind. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you create life and you watch over all of life. And we thank you that you are there and we can turn to you at all those significant moments in our lives and every day in between. And Lord, we bring before you those facing sad times or happy times at the moment. We think of those preparing to be married. We thank you for the gift of marriage and we ask for your blessing on them. We think of those suffering bereavement and especially this morning of Leonard's family. And we ask for your strength, comfort and hope for them. And we pray that each one of us might walk closely with you and know for ourselves and bear witness to the hope that only you can give us. In Jesus' name, amen. Just some other bits of information about things that are happening. If you are newish here, you can get a copy of our weekly newsletter by email, by simply contacting the church office. Have a word with me afterwards if you want me to sort that for you. And there's lots of things in there, but a couple of things I just want to highlight. Next Sunday, after the service, we're going to have something special going on here. So we'd love you to stay for a little while after the service to see what's going on and contribute to it. The diocese is running a series of pop-up vision cafes all over the diocese to hear people's ideas about how the church can best serve and witness in our times and help discern and formulate a vision for the diocese. And that's what we're going to be hosting here. I've seen one of them in action and it was really engaging. Lots of interesting activities, crafts, questions, things like that. And you can stay for 5 minutes or 30 minutes depending what time you've got, but you might find actually you want to stay longer than you think when you see what's here. And there's going to be some music going on while that's taking place. So just to make you aware of that and encourage you to stay next week after the service for that. There's also a few links in the newsletter to things that are worth looking at, including recent statements from the Church of England on the living in love and faith and human sexuality, including recent podcasts by bishops in the diocese. So do have a look and pick up on those. And there's also a couple of opportunities coming up to join together with us for breakfast in the church hall, 5th of February and 26th of March. So the first of those is just a couple of weeks away. You don't need to book, you can just turn up, and more details in the newsletter. We'd love to see you there, you'd be very welcome. And as always, there's lots of opportunities here to get involved in serving God. And you can find out more on our website or on the coloured chart that's over on the notice board over there, different groups and activities that have a need at the moment for people to help. Do have a chat with me if you want to know more. You've heard about Super Crèche this morning. There's also another opportunity to work with younger children. Little Fishes, our carer and toddler and baby group, very much in need of helpers on Tuesday mornings at the moment. So again, have a word with me if you're interested in that. I think that's all I'm going to highlight, but do take time to look through the rest of the information that's in the newsletter. And there are one or two hard copies by the door if you need one. So we're going to join together now in confession. God makes us an amazing promise through Jesus Christ. We know if we look at all at our own lives with any degree of self-awareness that we often fail, we get things wrong, and we do things that God does not want us to do, and we fail to do things that he does, and we sometimes do that deliberately, we sometimes do it thoughtlessly, but he makes the amazing promise of forgiveness when we come to him through Jesus. So as we join together in our confession now, let's hear that promise that he makes and receive the forgiveness that he gives. So let us return to the Lord our God and say to him, Father, we have sinned against heaven and against you. We are not worthy to be called your children. We turn to you again. Have mercy on us. Bring us back to yourself as those who once were dead, but now have life through Christ our Lord. Amen. May God, who loved the world so much that he sent his Son to be our Saviour, forgive you your sins and make you holy to serve him in the world, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And the collect, the special prayer for today. God of all mercy, your Son proclaimed good news to the poor, release to the captives, and freedom to the oppressed. Anoint us with your Holy Spirit and set all your people free to praise you in Christ our Lord. Amen. Please remain seated for our Bible reading.
Reading this morning is from Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 to 4, and if you wish to follow, it can be found in the Pew Bibles on page 1184. Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Pam. Before David comes to speak to us on that passage, we're going to stand to sing again, Before the Throne of God Above, a hymn which speaks of what God has done for us through Jesus. And just those words in verse 2, upward I look and see him there who made an end of all my sin. Please stand to sing. May your word be our guide, your spirit our teacher, your will our desire, to the glory of your name. Amen. Please sit down. It'd be really helpful, I think, if you have the Bibles open. It's page 1184, page 1184, Colossians chapter 3. And verses 1 to 4. One of the security questions from my online banking is,
What is your favourite holiday destination? I wonder what you'd choose. Somewhere sunny. A coastal resort, perhaps, in France or Spain or Greece. Or perhaps you go rather for scenery. Scotland, Austria, Switzerland. What would your answer be? Well, my choice was... Oh, I can't tell you. Because if I did, I'd have to kill you afterwards. Okay, it's a weak joke. It's all I can manage at this time in the morning. Of course, the question could have been about other favourites. Your favourite meal. Liver and onions for me. Or, as my wife would say, he means onions and liver. I love fried onions. Well, the question might be your favourite football team or TV programme. But if you've been asked, what is your favourite Bible verses? Ones that are very special to you. What would you say? Yes, we all love Psalm 23 or Isaiah 53, but I mean more than that. Do you have some verses that are a lifeline to you, which always refresh your spirit, bring a feeling of renewal to your life? Verses you turn to when times are tough. Because let's be honest, the Christian life isn't always plain sailing, is it? We have times of stress, of dryness, perhaps of doubt. Times when we feel that our inward Christian life isn't matching our outward profession of faith. When we feel we're drifting away from God. Do you ever feel like that? Well, if you do, let me tell you, you're not alone. And it's in times like these that favourite verses are a lifeline. So when David asked me what passage I'd like today, I immediately said Colossians 3, 1 to 4. Because these verses are my lifeline and my life guide. My lifeline? Because they assure me that however I feel, I am safe in Christ. My life guide? Because they give me a guide to living now and security for the future. And so I'd like to share these verses with you this morning. So here we are, page 1184. Well, I'm going to do the traditional thing and have three headings, about 20 minutes. I could have given a longer talk. David would have allowed it. But I know what you prefer. So, what are my three headings? Well, they're very easy to remember. They are the past, the present, and the future. The past. How do we start as a Christian? The present. What does it mean to be a Christian day by day? And the future. What is our future if we are Christians? So firstly, the past. How does the Christian life start? Well, I'm going to begin not with verse 1, but with verse 3, where it says, "For you died." This is the beginning. Our Christian life starts when we say, "I am not how I want to be." Paul puts it like this in Romans chapter 7, "I do not understand what I do. For what I want to do, I do not do. And what I hate, I do. I have the desire to do good, but I cannot carry it out. Have you been there? And then you hear the call of Jesus. Come to me, all who are burdened, and I will refresh you. Inviting us to begin a new life with him. And we accept. And so begins our Christian life. We start a new relationship with Jesus. And like all relationships, this is two-way. So Jesus goes on, take my yoke upon you. And the picture is of two oxen ploughing side by side, joined by a double yoke, keeping them in step, each with the other. And when Jesus says, come to me, it's a two-way agreement. That is, we give up our own ways, our own desires, in order to walk with him. And that's why verse 3 says, you died. Because you died to your own ways and desires. But it goes on. Your life is now hidden, safe with Christ in God. And so, is Jesus still with me in my bad times, the dry times, the times when I feel so distant from him? Yes, your life is now hidden with Christ in God. I am secure in Christ, because his promise is unfailing. But I said, this relationship is two-way. So we have to ask, is it costly for us to be yoked with Christ? Well, it may be. But let's ask a different question. Was it costly for Jesus to be yoked to us? It most certainly was. It meant that he who came from the glory of heaven trod the human load to its end. Unthinkably, he had to experience death, and it was a death that meant so much more to him than we think of. Because for him, experiencing death meant separation from God, his eternal Father. And so we hear that terrible cry of desolation on the cross. My God, why have you forsaken me? Yes, it cost him to be yoked to us. It cost him dearly. But that was not his last word on the cross. The last word on the cross was, it is finished. A word of triumph, a word of victory. He had overcome the last enemy, death. And verse 1 tells us, he now sits at the right hand of God. And so, the yoke he offers us has not been broken by his death. He stays with us and we with him. And so that's why we read in verse 1, you have been raised with Christ. So that's the first reason why this verse is so special to me. It reminds me that I may call myself a Christian not because I go to church or because I try to live a good life. No, not at all. It's because once having accepted Christ's invitation, my life is safe with him. You died, yes, but you have been raised with Christ, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. That's our first point the past. So to our second point, these are also verses for the present. Our society is moving away from faith in Christ, increasingly ruled by strident voices which insist we conform to their views, views which may not be actively anti-Christian, but are seldom based on what Jesus said or obedient to the scriptures. And in such a society, which we cannot escape, Paul calls us in verses 1 and 2, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. Hearts and minds. Hearts, our desires and ambitions, things we aspire to, things which drive us. And minds, how we evaluate the values and practices of today's society. Let's look at hearts first. Set your hearts on things above. We might say, remember whose you are and base your life's ambitions on that. Your life is now hidden with Christ in God, says Paul. So live as someone whose desire is to please him. So we ask ourselves, what comes first in our ambitions, our goals, our behavior? Is it our own interest? How will this serve me? Or perhaps our own comfort comes first. Oh, that's too much effort, we think, when the Lord draws our attention to someone's needs. Or do we think, how can I serve others, even though there's a cost to myself? In our careers, are we prepared to forego opportunities which clash with our obedience to Christ? Now, there's nothing wrong with ambition, but if our Christian life takes second place to our ambitions, then we need to hear these verses. Mark Mitchell gave up a very successful car franchise because he was required to start opening on a Sunday. Set your heart on things above, where Christ is. It doesn't mean a monastery or a convent. It simply means saying to Christ, is this what you want? What about minds? Well, here I want to look at our place in society. Jesus said, you are the salt of the earth, and salt improves and purifies. And so this verse, I think, is asking us to assess today's society with Christian minds, to question opinions, decisions, business practices, to bring all these to Christ, seated at the right hand of God. Now, it's not easy to hold views that don't fit the accepted norms of the day. Perhaps today more than ever. Strident voices insist we accept their truth as being dominant. We have to be strong, perhaps unpopular, to hold to a Christian view of society. But to bring Christian truth to bear on a situation means, of course, we have to be clear what that truth is. the Scriptures, especially the New Testament, are our starting point. And we must work with our minds to ensure we understand them correctly. How much is eternal truth? And how much first century custom? If we are trying to convince others to follow God's way, we need to be sure of our biblical ground. We need to be clear what the Bible is truly saying. So where might this apply? Well, in politics. Who would we vote for and why? Existing business practices. Can we endorse these before God? Strike action. Not an easy decision, even if you're a union member. And if you're not, do you support your colleagues? It can be difficult standing against popular opinion. If we have not clearly set our minds on things above, we can so easily be wrong-footed. So, this may be a tough verse for the present, but at the same time, it's a reminder of who I want to please. So, it gives me support and encouragement as I live the Christian life in a secular society. So there's two challenges for the present. What are our goals in life? And do they fit with our Christian discipleship? And what is our Christian contribution to a secular society? Well, so to our last and shorter section. These are verses for the future. Verse 4. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. I love the pictures that John gives in the last book of the New Testament, Revelation chapters 21 and 22, his description of a new heaven and a new earth, the city of God, with a river of the water of life flowing from the throne of God and of the Lord. Wonderful pictures. And yet, will I be there? Will God really, as Paul writes in Philippians, transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his, that is, like Jesus' glorious body? The older you become, death becomes not just a word, but an event which you know will happen to you. You can't envisage how, but you know it's coming. An unwelcome event, because it means leaving your loved ones, your friends, all you have known. A human fear. But these verses are the answer to our human fears. Since you have been raised with Christ, when Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. So I will appear with him in glory. Impossible though that might be to imagine. So to conclude, these favourite verses of mine are for all times and all seasons. They remind me of the past, Christ's initial invitation to me. They guide me in the present, calling me to look to Him in all situations. They comfort me for the future, because I am safe in Him. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, there are times when we all need the assurance, when however much we want to follow You, we know we don't. However much we want to stand for You, we know we fail. And we thank You so much, Lord, for these verses, which bring us back to the eternal truths, the eternal certainties, the eternal confidence, the eternal safety that we have in You. Thank You, Lord, for them. In Jesus' name.
Thank you so much, David. We're going to stand now to declare our faith. And as we do so, we can bear in mind those what David has shared with us and those wonderful verses and what they contain. So please stand. Let us declare our faith in God. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with His love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. We're now going to sing this wonderful song, which fits so well, I think, with those verses. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Jesus, to You we lift our eyes.
Thank you.
Be seated as Rachel comes to lead us in our prayers.
Let's pray together. Your word, O Lord, is eternal. It stands firm in the heavens. Your faithfulness continues through all generations. You establish the earth and it endures. Your laws endure to this day, for all things serve you. Dear loving Lord, this morning we have come into your presence, recognizing our great need of you in our lives. You are the source of all love, compassion, justice, and peace. So, Lord, as we approach you, we open our hearts to you and invite you to reign over our thoughts and actions. You gave everything for us in living, dying, and rising again to bring reconciliation to our broken world. Wherever we are on our journey of faith, we pray for the empowering of your Holy Spirit. Equip us, Lord, to be your true disciples, desiring you to be at the very center of our lives. In your wonderful name we ask this. Amen. As we look at our world, we see conflict, wars in many places, infighting within homes and communities. We see that the world needs so much the intervention of the power of your Holy Spirit, bringing your love and forgiveness, which sweeps away enmity and anger and in its place gives your peace. We pray particularly for Ukraine, and we pray for courage for the people who are fighting on the front line and those supporting them. May they all be very aware that many Christians throughout the world are praying for them. And we pray for the Christian charity Barnabas Aid, who supports persecuted Christians, and their prayer for today. Our Father in heaven, we ask you to comfort Christians in many countries who have lost their homes and livelihoods, even loved ones, in natural disasters. Strengthen our brothers and sisters in Pakistan, Nigeria, and Chad who have fled their homes because of rising floodwaters. We pray for the provision of food, water, and medicine for those in the Horn of Africa experiencing famine conditions. Please help those still rebuilding their lives months after the cyclone in Madagascar and typhoon in the Philippines. Thank you that you are the God who restores. Just as you intervened to preserve your people in the famine in Egypt, we ask you to restore your people again. We ask in the name of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. In our diocese, we ask that wisdom and vision will be given as discussions are opened up on the 29th of January after church for a vision cafe to reach out to our community. We pray for extra volunteers too needed in the various areas of our church work, including super creche and little fishes. Thank you for all those who are already engaged in young people's work. Give them a great love and insight into that vital work. Amen. Dear Lord, today we are celebrating the 62 years of ministry that David Jack has given us as lay reader. May he know your peace and joy of a life filled with service to you. Bless him and Muriel as they continue their fellowship with us. In your precious name we ask this. Amen. Dear loving Lord, we bring before you those who are unable to join us today. For those who are unwell at home or in hospital, recovering from illness or surgery, we pray that they will all know the joy of your company in their hearts. We pray for comfort for those who are mourning. May they experience your peace in their sorrow. In your name we pray. Gracious Lord, thank you for being with us in our worship this morning. Remind us this week of your faithfulness and help us to firmly set our minds and hearts on you, that we might know you more and experience the depth of your love for us. All these prayers we ask in your glorious name. Amen. So shall we end with the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Thank you, Rachel. I'm going to invite David to come and join me now for a few minutes. I did say a little later in the service that I'd be talking with him. So, David, I'm going to give you that one, if that's all right. So, David, tell us, why and how did you become a reader?
It's a bit loud in this. When I was at university, I was converted in the first a few weeks at university, and while I was there, at some stage, I read these verses, and here I need a third hand, but just a second. I want to get them. want to get them exactly right. Okay, so it's in Romans 10, verse 14. It says this: how then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in one of whom they have not heard? And here it comes: and how can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can anyone preach unless they are sent? And those verses just stuck with me. And I thought, well, yeah, that's something I've got to do. And that's where that began anyway. So I came back home and found an Anglican church, an evangelical Anglican church. And where's this going? Oh, I know, yes. I went to the vicar and said, I want to become a leader. And he says, oh, no, that's not the way we do things at all. You don't ask us, we ask you. So I said, okay, will you ask me then? So I did. And unlike now, which is now a ridiculously long training course, I sat on two Saturday mornings, two papers each Saturday morning, and that was it. And then I was qualified to be a leader.
So where was your first sermon?
My first sermon was actually, I remember it well, it was in a village in Oxfordshire where the Christian Union of the university used to send out preachers. And I went to this unsuspecting little Baptist church. I had the most fantastic tea I've ever had in my life. And then I went into the church with my hosts and I saw the pulpit, which was high and lifted up, to quote, and on it a big cushion. And I just felt so, well, really, how am I? You know, what was I then, 20? But that was my first sermon anyway, yeah.
So how is a reader preaching different from someone ordained?
I think, let's sort of look at the ordained side at the moment. What we look for, I think, from ordained people is more knowledge, more spirituality. We look to them to unlock verses, to challenge us in our spiritual life. At least that's what I do anyway. But an ordained person, by their very nature, does not work 9 to 5 in an office somewhere, or maybe delivering, or whatever the job happens to be. They're not amongst all the time people who are not believers. And also, therefore, they don't get the opportunity to challenge some of the practices, shall we say, which go on in everyday life. And that, I think, is what a leader can bring. Looking at the secular life, the Monday to Friday life in business, and applying Christian, or trying to apply Christian truths to it. That's what I hope, anyway, is part of my contribution.
Yeah. And what have you enjoyed or not enjoyed about preaching over the years?
I don't enjoy this, I'll tell you that now. what do I enjoy? I've got some answers here. Well, it takes time, obviously. But if you feel you are contributing to people's understanding of what the Christian faith means to them in their everyday lives, then that, I think, is the whole point. Similar to the last question, is the whole point of a leader's preaching. And when I'm preparing, I am thinking of people in the congregation. Who might this apply to? You know, how can I make that relevant to them? And when, hopefully, afterwards they say, oh, that was really helpful, and mean it, then that makes it all worthwhile.
Yeah, thank you. You talked in your sermon today about hearts and minds, and you talked about the tensions, the clashes sometimes between Christian faith and work life. So where have those clashes been for you? When's your Christian faith clashed with your work life?
Well, I suppose you're on duty, as it were, all the time. But there's two events which stick in my mind. One is quite trivial, really, and one is almost quite serious. When I first started a job with a computer consultancy, after a few weeks, a colleague and I went out to see a customer. And when we came back, he said, oh, you're claiming for breakfast? So I said, well, no, we didn't have breakfast. Well, you had breakfast on the train. Yeah, we didn't have breakfast. Oh, well, that means I can't claim either. And we never really got on after that. He held that against me. And I was there for, 13, 14 years. That was one. It was really quite trivial, but it was quite early on. It was quite difficult. The other one, which stands in my mind, was in my last job. A manager was proposing something. It was a meeting of managers, and the senior manager was there. And he was proposing something which I thought wasn't on. And I could tell from the sort of body language of my colleagues that they thought it wasn't on either. But he was a very senior manager. And I thought, well, I can't say, I'm sorry, as a Christian, I don't agree with that, because that wouldn't have washed at all. Unfortunately, God gave me an answer then, and I could frame my answer in a way which was to the benefit of the company. Unfortunately, it was accepted, and afterwards some of my colleagues said to me, you know, we're glad you said that. But that was quite a tense moment, because if I'd come out of that meeting not having said anything, I would have known I'd failed in my Christian life. So those are two brief examples.
Yeah. Okay. So coming back to today, I'm sure the question in a lot of people's minds is, you, from hearing you preach today, you're clearly not past it. So why retire now?
Well, I will be past it one day. And I don't want to inflict myself upon you when I am. And the question is, if not now, when, really? You know, 87, 90, 95? You know, I don't think you'd welcome that, being helped up the steps. And so once you've sort of thought along those lines, then you say, well, when exactly? And it seemed to me you want to have a reason for the particular day. And today, as you've heard, is an exact anniversary of when I was made leader. So I chose that.
Mm. I mean, you talked about preparation getting harder over time.
Yeah.
And I know I've heard similar things from others. As years advance, it gets harder to kind of put things together. But apart from that, have you found it hard being a reader?
I don't think so. It's something when you feel you want to do it, then it's something, you know, you put up with the work involved, whatever it happens to be. It does get harder. I was talking to a couple of older clergy over the last couple of years, and they both said the same thing. And I was talking to a friend of mine who's more the same age as me, who's also a leader, and he was saying just the same thing. Can't explain this. I suppose it's because just like your limbs get stiffer, so your brain gets stiffer, if you like. Sorry, what was the question?
Have you, are there things you found hard about being a reader?
What have we got down here? Yeah, when I was younger, I asked my family, who I didn't expect to see here today, but I'm very grateful that they've made the journey from all over the country. They had to pay the price, because I was away in the study, you know, working on things, and therefore couldn't be in the house. That's hard. You have to spend a lot of time. I mean, I guess it takes me about 20 hours to prepare a sermon. By the time you've read some of the commentaries to get the understanding of what the passage really means, the background, and so on, then you start thinking how you're going to present it. And then you start thinking about examples and getting the amount right and so on, all that. So, but that's a price you pay. I think the biggest price is probably my family, as they've been growing up, as I've been spending time away from the household, as it were.
Mm. What's kept you going at times when it's been challenging?
I think there's two answers to that. One is what I said earlier on. When there are times when we drift away from the faith, we don't follow it up, we don't do our reading, we don't do our praying, we simply drift. We go to church, go through the motions perhaps. And that's when a favourite verse or verses, that's how you get pulled back then. The other occasion, though, is when if you're under pressure. I was under severe pressure at one point at work, where I was in charge of a project which day after day after day failed for reasons I now understand, but was actually nothing to do with me as it happened. But nevertheless, you know, I'd go into work each morning and I would see that the program had failed yet again, and it just got pressure and pressure and pressure. And God was just not there. There was too much else filling my mind. And perhaps the best way I can describe it is, if you know the footsteps poem or picture, where there's a pair of footsteps, and then there's a single footstep, and then there's another pair of footsteps, and Jesus says, "Well, where's this just one footstep? I was carrying you." And when there's pressure that you really filled your whole life, and then it's over, and you find God is still there waiting for you, and that's true, you know. So if you're under that pressure, God will be there. He doesn't forsake us, even though we forsake him.
Thank you. One final question, David. You were called all those years ago by God to be a reader and to have this preaching ministry. What would you say to someone who's trying to discern God's call? How can we know what he wants us to do?
I go back to the scriptures. I think you have to have a call from the scriptures. People will say to you sometimes, "Oh, you'd make a good preacher," or "I think you ought to do that." And you can get a bit big-headed about it. Unfortunately, that wasn't the way it happened to me, I'm glad to say. But I think you can get a big-headed and think, "Oh, yes, maybe I should do that. And that's not it at all. It's got to be a call from God. And in my view, it comes either from the scriptures directly, or maybe it comes from someone that's preaching. And you think, "I wonder if God's calling me in the same way to help others," because that's what it is. Preaching is there to help others. But don't just think, "Oh, I want to be a leader." That's not the way it is at all.
Yeah, thank you. And did you find that confirmed by people as well?
Oh, yes. I'm not sure I can really sort of answer that one, because it was, you know, it was university and stayed out, as it were. I suppose it's confirmed in a way once you've taken the step, because people say, "Oh, thank you for that." And there was a lady who came to me, I think just after the last time I preached, very clearly had found something in what I'd said. And that's tremendously rewarding. But in terms of the question you asked, David, I think you can, if you wonder if God is calling you, then go to somebody who you know might give you an answer you don't want to hear. You see what I mean? Yeah. So you're not just going to somebody and say, "Oh, yes, 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 we'll give you strokes." Somebody you trust, obviously, is somebody who you respect. And if they say yes, then you can be fairly certain that God is calling you.
Yeah, thank you. Well, David, this is the bit you really won't like.
No. I don't know what it is, but I'm not going to like it.
Because I need to say a huge thank you. We're enormously grateful to the Lord and to you for your ministry. St. Andrew's, and therefore so many people, have been blessed and helped to grow in faith and in living it out. through your preaching and your ministry. And I have personally hugely valued your ministry and our partnership as we've served together. I've valued your wisdom and your experience. And I've also been struck how, even after so many years, you've worked continually to grow and improve, learning to create and use PowerPoints and then asking for advice on how to improve them, learning to use the radio mic, joining conferences and training opportunities when they come up. And I think that's such a great example to us, because whatever we do in serving the Lord, we never arrive. We can always improve. We can always get better. And that's been a huge encouragement. You've been so faithful, committed and dedicated in your service to the Lord in everything you do, and in your heart for this church and its people and for reaching others, and your desire to do things well and to serve the Lord well in all you do. So we're enormously grateful to you. And we have got a little token of our thanks, which I know you'll be cross about too, but it's right that we do that. So there's a card and a token for something that will enable you to do something that I know you'll enjoy. So that comes with our thanks and our blessing. So thank you so much. And may God continue to bless you and use you. And
I'll just see if I've grown angel's wings or not. I feel like...
Thank you, David. Thank you.
So thank you so much. And we're going to stand to sing now a final hymn, which again, I think just picks up on some of the things we've talked about. Great is thy faithfulness. And I'm always struck by those words in the last verse, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. And it's that present and future, those two of those three parts that you were talking about earlier on. So let's stand to sing, Great is thy faithfulness.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Let's first commit our financial gifts and our lives to God. Let us pray. Gracious God, accept our gifts and with them our lives to be used in your service through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We don't these days pass an offering plate around, but for any who want to make donations, most of our congregation give regularly through the bank, but we do have offering boxes by the doors, and we do have a card reader if anybody wants to use that at any time. Let's close in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you that you speak to us through the scriptures, that you work in our hearts, in our minds, and in our lives, that you use us to serve you and to do your work in the world. And we pray that you would work in each one of us today, that you would help us to hold in our minds and our hearts the things that you have given us through this time together this morning. We pray that you'd help us to walk closely with you through the week ahead and each and every week, and know your guiding hand over our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. May the Father, from whom every family in heaven and earth receives its name, strengthen you with his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, and that knowing his love, broad and long, deep and high, beyond our knowledge, you may be filled with all the fullness of God. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among us and remain with us now and always. Amen. So glad you've joined us today. Do stay and chat. There'll be refreshments at the back.